We are very pleased and honored to have with us Professor Nesteruk, Senior Lecturer in the Mathematics of the University of Portsmouth. Would you like to introduce yourself?
As you said, I'm teaching at the University of Portsmouth. I'm also doing research at the University of Portsmouth. And at the same time, I'm not only in England, I'm part of the Russian establishment. I'm a sort of lecturer in the Russian Academy, Russian Christian Academy of the Human Sciences in St. Petersburg. I'm involved in interdisciplinary research related to cosmology, to philosophy of science, and theology. This is just in brief.
Professor Nesteruk, you are one of the leading experts in the field of Orthodox Christianity in science. You are one of the pioneers of working recently on this subject. How did you decide to work on this interdisciplinary area?
It's quite a difficult question because the idea of actually doing something systematically came to my mind probably 25 years ago when I was involved in the first dialogues between science and theology in Russian after the collapse of the Soviet Union. Then when I came to, in 1993, I came to Oxford and I spent 1 year as a postdoctoral fellow. I decided to study theology and I became acquainted with all bulk of the English literature on theology, which did not exist by that time in Russia. And in particular, I was also influenced by people from the Oxford community of scientists and theologians and the European Society for the Study of Science and Theology. And with the help of their friendship, I determined a particular trend in actually approaching this field. In particular, I realized that in order to avoid many fallacies and many flaws of I would say popular treatment of scientific ideas, it would be much more interesting to actually bring in correlation the rigorous science together with actually proper theology. But theology, since we are talking about the Eastern Orthodox Christian tradition, this theology was radically different from the philosophical theology of the West. And in particular, the idea was how to reconcile the idea of communion, idea of participation in the divine, which is so actually pertaining to Orthodox ethos, how to reconcile this idea with scientific experience. In other words, the main idea which underlined my thought since then, it means for 25 years, is how to reconcile actually different type of experience, because it was clear for me as a philosopher, because I also had a philosophical education in Russia, that it's extremely difficult to avoid a very simple issue that science and theology, they are both products of human mind, human spirit, and in this sense, any split or any visible, let's say, contradiction or conflict, it's fallacious, actually. Think why? Because it appears and emerges from one and the same human being. So that's why, in some sense, we need to reconcile this experience in yourself, first of all. And this means that in many ways, science became for me not only an objective description of reality, but as I always was saying to my fellow colleagues, that I mean, you can study physics, for example, but you study physics not as a physicist, but as a psychologist. Through studying physics, you study how you actually interact with reality, with the creation of good creation by good God. And that's why, in this sense, you study yourself. And in this sense, for myself, science always was a part of a psychological discourse. It's not something which is unrelated to spiritual or ascetic development. It's part of a particular vision with respect to reality, which doesn't contradict any mystical vision or any type of communion, only by a simple fact that it appears in your living experience, in the gift of life, which is, again, it's a gift. It's a gift by God. And that's why the foundation of science itself, if we ask the question, or for example, of the dialogue between science and theology, I would rephrase this question. The question is not about dialogue. The question is about justification of science on the theological grounds, because unfortunately, scientists, many scientists in different scientific committees, they cannot answer an elementary question, why science is possible. And this question comes again from human being, because human being has consciousness, it has divine gift of articulating reality and positioning this in a sort of advanced linguistic and, I would say, mental form. And that's why the question becomes, in some sense, anthropological. And theology becomes inevitable discourse of anthropology. And correspondingly, if you want to justify science on the grounds of anthropology, you can't avoid theology. Theology is always there. And tomorrow I will be talking, for example, about this in my talk. I don't know whether I exhausted.
You actually preemptively answered a number of my questions. So if you feel that I've already asked something, please be merciful. I would like to ask a bit more on which were influential scholars or influential books that inspired you as you approached the subject.
I mean, there were two, I would say, even three sides of this influence, because on my scientific part, I was very lucky in my life because I worked with two very prominent physicists. The first was Ilya Prigozhin. He's a famous physicist, was of originally Russian, I would say, descent, because he was his parents emigrated in 1917 and he was actually in Belgium, but his name was Russian, and he worked on the idea of irreversibility of time. He was very very ambitious in order to create a theory of time which would be, as I say, local, creating an idea of a quantum of time which pushes time forward and makes actually that temporal flow irreversible. And I was under influence of him when I was in Brussels in 1991. And then in 1993, I came to Oxford where I met Roger Penrose, another famous mathematician and physicist in Britain, who was actually developing a slightly different model, because according to him, the concept of time and the irreversibility of time is related to the initial conditions in the universe, which is completely opposite idea. And I was influenced by both of them, but at the same time, I realized that both the theories, in spite of the fact that they're different, they have one particular philosophical, fundamental philosophical premise about existence of intelligible reality which underlies physical reality, and the appeal to this reality ultimately brings to the visible flux of time. And I started to think about this in both directions, and this brought me to fundamental questions about actually origin of the universe, the age of the universe, about the region of irreversibility, temporal flux. And this was combined with my philosophical background, because as I said to you before, that after I got my PhD in physics, I was a part-time PhD student in Russia on philosophy, and I decided actually to apply the full scale of phenomenological philosophy in order to deal with these issues. And then came theology, because theology, it was the concluding term in my, I would say, renovation after actually coming out of the Soviet Union, because, I mean, I learned a little bit of my personal history. I learned, for example, that my great-grandfather, he was a priest in the capital, the former capital of Russia, Novgorod. And I knew about his tragic history in the 1920s, 1930s, during the Stalin purges and other things. And I started to develop a very, very sincere, I would say, feeling. I would say not interest, but feeling towards my past, which brought me to the church, ultimately. And that's why you asked me a question about influence. In the theological part, I mean, definitely in the previous years, I was influenced by all sorts of Russian religious philosophy, which was produced in Paris during the 20th century, the Russian School of Philosophy. And in the Western part, I was very much influenced by many different theologians, in particular, not even non-Orthodox theologians. I'm not saying about your compatriots, John Zizoulis and Christos Yanaras, who are still, I consider, as the best theologians in the world. But I mean, I was influenced by, for example, Protestant theologians such like Thomas Torrance. I knew him personally, who was actually very, very knowledgeable about Orthodox tradition. And he influenced me through different ideas. In particular, I translated into Russian his book, Space, Time, and Incarnation. And I'm still working actually on this topic because I believe that the Orthodox theology is lacking fundamentally understanding of this problem of the incarnation and the underlying behind this problem of pneumatology. So, and you see, theology and science were clearly represented. I cannot say the same about philosophy because philosophy, it was a difficult formation because I like a particular stance in philosophy related to transcendentalism. It's a Kantian philosophy and philosophy of Edmund Husserl, phenomenology. But nowadays, I'm deeply involved in the French development of phenomenology related to Catholic philosophers, for example, Jean-Luc Marion, Michel Henry, Jean-Louis Chrétien, and others. And I consider their writings on philosophy and Christianity as outstanding and very, very profound. And I believe that as Orthodox theologians, we must, I underline this word, we must appropriate them and we must understand what is going on, because if we want to have this theology be contemporary, modern, and accessible to the Western and to the worldwide reader, this theology must be rephrased. And this was part of different, I would say, claims today, for example, at the conference. So, in other words, I mean, this is just a combination of factors which contributed to my ultimate approach to science and theology, because as you know, I mean, this particular approach which I follow, I mean, it's different in comparison with other people, for example, present at this conference. And that's why I cannot avoid, and this is my fundamental claim, I cannot avoid a philosophical component of this dialogue, because if we remove this philosophical component, this dialogue becomes incomprehensible.
Thank you for this very comprehensive answer. I would like to go back to a previous point you mentioned and tie to some of your recent, and I mean the last decade, work, which seems to have focused on a neopatristic synthesis. This is a peculiar term, but it's one that is somewhat appropriate. A neopatristic synthesis of Orthodox Christian theology and science. This is a topic you have pursued for in two books and in several papers. So would you like to share your views on your recent efforts on that front?
Neopatristic idea is not definitely my idea. It's the term was proposed actually here in Athens in 1936 by famous Russian theologian George Florovsky. And by that time in 1936, neopatristic synthesis was very timely because the church practically didn't exist in Russia. It was an exile in Western Europe. And some theologians like George Florovsky and Vladimir Lossky, they were actually asking a question, what kind of route we have to reestablish in order to bring theology to a proper liturgical and communal style, in order to avoid all problems related with abstractness of theology, its scholastic character, which actually was present before the revolution in Russia. And the neopatristic synthesis certainly must be understood very carefully, because some people, they consider this as blind retrieval towards ancient absolute past, which practically does not exist anymore, and any appeal to this, for example, to the Orthodox tradition, to patristic tradition, is irrelevant. And in some sense, I would say they are right, because we must not treat patristic synthesis and patristic heritage as something which is up to date in terms of, let's say, politics, in terms of application in the dialogue with science, in terms of dealing with technology and other things. But the main idea of neopatristic synthesis is, but it's a particular acquisition of the vision of the fathers when the reality of the outer world was not presented as an object which is completely detached from the articulating consciousness, but in fact to bring this world, to bring the whole creation back into this consciousness and to give this an absolutely different treatment. If I say in modern philosophical terms, the neopatristic synthesis and the appeal of Florovsky, it's a change of mind, effectively. It's a change of mind which can be described by using the Greek word metania, or it can be described as the change of the attitude, if I use philosophical language. And it is a such change of attitude when you don't treat science anymore as some outward, I would say, external irrelevant activity for the spiritual and aesthetic development of human being. So in other words, my idea was to say that we want to re-establish a particular type of vision, because neopatristic synthesis, it's not a practical agenda. In a sense, I mean, we don't propose any particular practical establishing of practical relationship, let's say, between physics and theology, because in fact, this is not the objective. This is not objective because I don't believe in this objective anyway, because I believe that physics is physics, and people who are doing atomic bombs and doing experiments with elementary particles, they will do this regardless to whatever theologians will say anyway, because this is just part of experience. The question is different, is an attempt to understand the meaning of this in spiritual terms and to understand how human mind being split in itself between two different modes of actually comprehension of reality, the mode which is inside from within the fact of creation, from the fact of creation of life, from the fact of the gift of life, the unknowability of this gift. It's a one perspective when you look at the world, and another perspective when you distract completely from this, I would say, insight, and you look at the world as if this world is developed and governed by some objective laws, some objective mechanisms which have nothing to do with you. This type of thing is possible, and we know since the 17th century, since the so-called era of scientific revolution, this approach is possible. But it doesn't mean that this approach is exhaustible, because unfortunately, and the main problem of this approach, it does not answer the fundamental question, who is man? Who is human being, because the mystery of the human being remains absolutely untouched by this type of approach in science. Correspondingly, if I come back to your question about neopatristic synthesis, the whole idea, again, is the change of attitude. Change of attitude when you look at the universe, for example, because universe is the subject of my research, when you look at the universe not from the point of view of separate physical objects, like stars, galaxies, and all of these objects, effectively sterile, absolutely hostile. No life is possible, even if we discovered 400 exoplanets, we know that nothing is possible over there. Correspondingly, what I want to say that it's an attempt to look at the creation from the point of view of the centrality of human being. So that's why I would say that neopatristic synthesis, if you look carefully in the ideas of the fathers, it's idea when you articulate actually creation from within humanity. Because without humanity, you cannot actually talk about the universe. The very word universe, it's a human invention, it's a human word. Effectively, if you distract this link, or if you cut this umbilical cord between the universe and human being, you predicate something which is non-existential and very abstract, and you don't know how to actually reconcile the mystery of your existence with this objective world, because your existence in a galaxy or in the universe becomes absolutely nonsensical, because it's negligible, it's practically non-existent. That's why neopatristic, it's very difficult, and in my book on Universal Communion, I'm trying to advocate that the neopatristic synthesis, it's a change of attitude, which is similar to what phenomenology calls the shift from the natural attitude, when you consider the world as an object, towards the so-called phenomenological or philosophical attitude, when the whole world becomes an event in you. It's a completely different thing. In this sense, it's a little bit mystical. And that's why I received some accusations of crypto-mysticism in this type of writing. And this is true. I don't deny this, because in some sense, the philosophy which I use, I mean, it's itself, by definition, mystical, because it changed your perception of reality.
this actually brings me to my next question. One of the striking points in your argumentation, for someone who reads it as an outside observer, if we say, is the role exactly you ascribe to human personhood, to human existence, and to the point of human when trying to explain the cosmos. This is a very striking feature of your work. And I would like to very specifically ask you to share your views on this, on this subject of the role of personhood and humanhood in your argument.
I can start from a very simple philosophical observation. And here I appeal to everyone, to scientists and to theologians, not to be ignorant about this, that one of the major stances of existential philosophy in the 20th century was that the primary fact of existence can be affirmed only within the fact of human life. So that's why, effectively, if you try to predicate existence in non-existential terms by proclaiming that there exists something which is not related to human beings, then this is an act of blind faith. I mean, you can believe in this, but you can't prove, because, I mean, the point that any proof, when you want to actually leave the so-called hermeneutic or epistemological circle, this proof doesn't exist. And philosophy, since ancient Greek philosophy for 2,500 years, they know this quite well. And that's why my fundamental point that any predication of the universe, if you treat the universe, for example, as creation, good creation by good God, any consideration of the divine and any attempt to formulate in linguistic theological terms the divine, any formulation of the linkage between human beings and divine predetermines existence of a subject of this predication, which means that human being is the fundamental, as people say in philosophy, it's a center of manifestation and disclosure. And that's why without human being, all talks about, I would say, outer world, about, for example, scientific activity or technology, don't have any sense, because ultimately it's a production of humanity. The question is, and this is much more difficult, that what we call human being, because human being can be understood in different way. We can talk about biological human beings, and we have a big biological mass on this planet of 7.5 billions. We can talk about individuals, but then, and this is exactly where orthodoxy comes forth, that we are talking not about actually human beings like this, we are talking about hypostatic human beings, about persons. Persons and personhood becomes a particular attribute of the preservation of the center of existence, when you can formulate the existence starting from yourself. And why? I mean, the question is, because existence, and I will be talking about this tomorrow at the conference, it's something which cannot be reduced to, as people say, metaphysica generalis. You cannot deduce existence of person from something which pre-exists person, because there is nothing pre-exists person. So that's why this is the ultimate reference point. And for example, Martin Heidegger, he called this Dasein. Dasein is a presence, as the fundamental ontological reference to the existence of humanity as life. The most important thing, and this is exactly sometimes disregarded in theological circles, that when we talk about hypostatic existence, about personhood, we must remember that this is incarnate, it's embodied personhood. This means that this personhood related with a particular physical condition. It's related to the body. And this makes our situation particularly vulnerable. Vulnerable because person, it's exactly this type of existence which tragically experiences the dualism between being enslaved by the conditions of physics and biology, at the same time being free in terms of will, in terms of imagination, in terms of spiritual aspiration, free, and this freedom again cannot be reduced to any type of metaphysica generalis, because metaphysica generalis can explain you, let's say, the existence of your body, your cells, your blood. For example, we're sharing the same type of, I would say, kidney, a heart, but we cannot share hypostatic properties. Some people can object and say, all right, I mean, for example, today it was a talk on genetics, and they say, okay, these different hypostatic properties, maybe they correspond to different, I would say, these letters or in pathogens which appears in different bodies. The question is exactly not about this, because even if we claim this, we cannot prove. But the question is, a hypostatic and personal human being can ask the fundamental questions, which is completely inaccessible to anything in this universe. Why do I exist? What is the contingent facticity? What is the foundation of contingent facticity of my existence? And this question can be posed only by hypostatic human person. But from this question, we unfold actually the whole answer with respect to the whole universe, because the fact of our existence will bring us immediately to the question about existence of the whole physical world. So in other words, for example, I give you a very simple analogy that the question about the existence of the universe, the so-called Big Bang and the beginning of the universe, is very similar, if you analyze this phenomenologically, and I did this in my last book, it's very similar to the problem of birth or conception, when actually you don't have access to the conditions or sufficient conditions and contingent facticity of your own birth, because you cannot observe birth as a phenomenon from within already existing life. And that's why for humanity, it's a fundamental question of anxiety, the sense of existence, which is projected on the sense of the universe, sense of the universe. And then we have the theology, because without theology, we cannot answer this question, because, I mean, we clearly understand that we do not control our existence. And since we do not control our existence is controlled by someone else. And this brings us the theological foundation of our existence and theological foundation of the universe. I mean, I just reminded St. Maximus the Confessor in the 7th century, he formulated in one of his profound works on mystagogy exactly three problems: existence of humanity, existence of the universe, existence of the church. Existence of the church together with God. So in this sense, it's clear that we are still, if we are dealing with the dialogue between science and theology, we are still in the condition of the so-called perennial philosophy. And for Greek philosophers, for example, for 2,500 years, these problems were already formulated. And these problems, they are still open. Because the question about actually the contingent foundation of the human existence from which you articulate the whole universe is not solved. And philosophy understands it quite well. And all pretense of science for solving this ultimate question is considered by philosophy as a naive. See, theology, it cannot explain, it cannot demonstrate, but at least it can give you interpretation. It can give you a sort of hope, which will be an existential motive.
Once again, you preemptively hinted at the question I wanted to make, and it was about Maximus the Confessor, which seems to be a very influential Christian father for scholars who are interested in the interaction of Orthodox Christianity and science in the last years. Would you agree with this assessment? And if yes, why is Maximus, St. Maximus the Confessor, so relevant now?
I cannot say that he is very popular in the dialogue between science and theology, because, I mean, to be honest, I know some works which actually quote Maximus the Confessor in this context. But, I mean, I cannot say that this is a sort of paradigmal figure. Because Maximus the Confessor himself, he never was particularly involved in this type of dialogue. And the question, again, is not about quoting St. Maximus the Confessor in order to extract some phrases from him which are relevant. This is not neopatristic synthesis, because the blind quotation of the fathers is not neopatristic synthesis. Neopatristic synthesis is completely different. It's acquisition of the mind of the fathers in order to look at the universe. So that's why when I appeal, for example, to St. Maximus the Confessor, it's because I'm learning from him how to think, first of all. And definitely this type of thinking, because he was a mystical man, he was in constant communion with God, and he was a very influential philosopher and a theologian by his time. Definitely, he touched upon the fundamental questions related to the interaction between man, God, and the universe. And in this sense, he is very, very indicative, unlike others, because there are many, many different Greek fathers and even Latin fathers. For example, we can take a talk about St. Augustine. I mean, he's extremely influential and absolutely prolific writer. But at the same time, St. Maximus, he gave a particular type of a synthesis when in his personal vision as a monk, he was able actually to create a synthesis of the three fundamental issues. It's the origin of man, its relationship of man to God, and correspondingly the origin and relationship between man and the universe, man and God. So in this sense, it's a kind of triad which influenced me many years ago because I realized that this type of synthesis would be very useful. But again, not in terms of quotation of St. Maximus the Confessor, but in terms of acquisition of his way of thinking and his vision. Because what I believe absolutely important in the contemporary dialogue, and this was, this was actually one of the ideas promoted today by our speakers, that the fundamental thing is reshaping this dialogue and understanding when we call this dialogue between science and theology, whether we are actually talking about the dialogue. I'm not sure at all, and tomorrow I will be arguing that this is not a dialogue, actually. It's not a dialogue, it's a completely different thing. It's a very precise demarcation between science and theology, which is disguised under the name of the dialogue, because the dialogue as such has a name. What is the name of the dialogue? For example, reconciliation of science and theology. But for Maximus the Confessor, the question of reconciliation never actually arose. Why? Because for him, it was absolutely clear that the experience of the divine can be of two different kinds. So that's why I also insist exactly on this, that, I mean, the dialogue, it's a very strange word, like mediation. Mediation, yes. But even if you talk about relationship between science and theology, this is a sort of absolutely voluntary argument which when we're trying to bring into correlation science and theology. But on what grounds? Because the fundamental point of, yes, I can propose this ground because this is anthropological ground. And I say, yes, there is a relationship between science and theology because both science and theology, they originate from the same human being. But this is the only ground which we have. All other attempts to bring actually them together and reshuffle on the table here, there, like this, and we know this in the West, for example, I mean, Jan Babo was quoted today at the conference, and his book was devoted to different models of relationship between science and theology, for example, consolation or reconciliation, let's say opposition. But the question is not about this, because when you do the work like this, you position yourself outside. This is science, this is theology, but this is exactly what is impossible. Because you are the being, when you have a gift of God to live, you cannot abstract yourself from theology and you can't abstract yourself from science, because by your body, you are functioning according to the laws of science.
So what would you consider, perhaps you want to give me those and I put it here because I think I we've, yes. Which characteristics of Orthodox Christianity would you say set it apart from other Christian denominations when considering its interaction with science? It's something you have hinted twice or thrice already.
I think, first of all, the very definition of theology, because people, they use this word theology, but to be honest, I'm sure that in the audience, in our conference, everybody has absolutely different meaning on theology. And the Orthodox vision of theology is first of all related to the, I would say, communion with God, and first of all, vision of God. The vision of God, which is absolutely inseparable with the mystical sense of theology. And if you read the Russian theologian Vladimir Lossky, you realize that he always saying that mysticism and theology are inseparable. In this sense, theology becomes, as many actually theologians in the 20th century were claiming, existential theology. Because, I mean, it's a theology of existence. It's not abstract theology, because abstract theology, which doesn't have God inside you, it becomes, as Diadochos of Photiki was saying in Philokalea, that it's the worst type of demonism. Because when you talk about God without presence of God in your heart, this is not theology. It's whatever you can call it. And that's why the fundamental point of Orthodox approach to theology is the theology of communion. And that's why any type of the dialogue between science and theology which avoids this dimension of communion becomes very suspicious from my point of view, because it's not dialogue between science and theology. It's a dialogue between the discipline of systematic theology, dogmatic theology, and the science. And you can reshuffle again these books and these ideas as much as you like. But what is the existential outcome? Because the point from the Orthodox point, from the Orthodox angle, is that you need to achieve a sort of result, because the Orthodox way and the Orthodox direction implies that you change. Because if you're a Christian and if you're involved in ecclesial life, you must change. Because if you're not changing, it's not clear what is the purpose of this in sense. And the change is related to a particular attitude, because you want to achieve. You want to achieve the vision of God, ultimately, as Archimandrite Sofroni Sakharov was quoted today, for example, in one of his books, To See God as He Is. It's exactly the point, because we want to achieve the vision of God. We want to achieve the vision of things as He sees them, which is extremely difficult. And you clearly understand that this objective is very ambitious, because it implies all sorts of ascetic stages. Stages related to the so-called deification. But I would say that from my personal practice, scientific experience can be brought by an Orthodox thinker, an Orthodox philosopher, in his or her heart. And this scientific experience can become an ascetic experience. And this is my fundamental claim. Because why? Why? Because the laws of nature, they are given by God at the very moment of creation. And this is a creation which we call good. Good creation by good God. This means that the laws of nature are given to us in order to know God. And that's why any attempt to deny this, any attempt of saying we don't need laws of physics in order to understand God, we can be saved without this, this is a fundamental fallacy. If I would be Metropolitan John Zizioulas, who lives in Athens, I would say, because you remember Metropolitan John, many years ago, he proclaimed the following thing, that the abuse of nature is a sin. And he publicly did this at the conference, ecological conference, under the auspices of the Ecumenical Patriarch. But if I would be like him, I would say that more I study physics and more I study the human condition, the very fragile human condition on this planet, in this particular social and political turmoil, in this particular situation when the world is standing on the brink of the war and other things, I think to disregard the laws of nature, it's a sin. So that's why to say that science, we don't need science and we disregard science completely because it doesn't help us to be saved, this is fundamentally wrong. Fundamentally wrong because human life itself now on this planet runs against the physical laws. And if we will not stop it under the influence of our consciousness, we will be in a big, big trouble. And we will never achieve the goal of salvation.
What areas would you consider to be especially underexplored in the Orthodox Christianity science dialogue, relation, or conversation?
First of all, and I will be talking about this tomorrow, it's a lack of philosophical platform, philosophical methodology. It's complete misunderstanding of the difference between theology of communion and science in philosophical terms. So that's why this is unfortunately unavoidable, because any attempt to deny the presence of philosophical element, it's again runs contrary to the history, for example, history of, let's say, Greek philosophy. So that's why if you disregard history of thought, I mean, you are running in an extremely, extremely eccentric exercise, which never existential. It cannot be existential because it's not true, because history still gives us truth. The second point, which again, I will be talking tomorrow if the time will allow me, The fundamental thing in the whole the dialogue between science and theology, it's a complete disregard for the concept of the fall. Because the concept of the fall, if we're seriously talking about this, it effectively explicated by the presence of science. Because according to the concept of the fall and the deviation of the human path from this paradisiac, I would say, way of development in communion with God, brings humanity to the necessity of being adapted to the conditions of nature, in particular adapted through the garments of skin. And in this sense, the whole scientific enterprise becomes a very interesting explication of this adaptation. So that's why science becomes theological by default. Why? Because it tells you what is a specific for the condition of the fall of human beings. And then we never, and scientists they would hate it. Scientists, they would burn me at stake for this if they would hear this. They're dealing with the condition of the world after the fall. And this makes a fundamental difference. Why? Because if we are living in the condition of the fall, no scientific theory can pretend for being complete, accomplished in giving us truth on the opposite side of the gates of paradise, because we cannot overcome the gates of the paradise from our side. In this sense, when we look at the pictures of the universe, on the galaxies, or on the Big Bang, we all say the following, that this all explicates exactly the perception of the world by human being in the condition of the fall. And that is why the human conditions which we have by definition brings us to this instability and infinite advance in science, which will never stop. But if infinite advance in science will never stop, the dialogue between science and theology will never stop. So that's why, forget about this. Leave all your hope, as it was said in Dante, when you enter this, I would say, enterprise. And the final thing which I want to tell you about Orthodox, this is a mostly theological thing, which is related to this and related to anthropology. It's a fundamental lack of the pneumatological dimension in this dialogue. Complete disregard of the issue of the Holy Spirit, which is very, very strange. Because when you deal with anthropology and when you deal with human beings, in particular if you deal with the anthropology of the divine image, you clearly understand that theology at least gives you a hint that if you're animated by the Holy Spirit, the very gift of life and very gift of articulation of the universe, ultimately it's a sort of indication towards the Holy Spirit. And the only way to indicate the presence of the Holy Spirit is human being. It's not an attempt of Wolfert Pannenberg to find the Holy Spirit in the theory of field. He was criticized heavily for this, but I mean, some attempts, they exist. Because I mean, people say, okay, there is a field in the universe, and maybe this field is the Holy Spirit. This is nonsense, because the Holy Spirit is transcendent. And that is why the only access to the Holy Spirit is through us. And that's why pneumatology must bring human being again to the center of disclosure and manifestation in the universe. And this, unfortunately, doesn't exist.
Moving on from that point, what role could Orthodox Christianity play today in current scientific practice, and vice versa, how could science affect the practice and experience of Orthodox Christianity? Do you think that's possible, or could or should be?
I tell you what, that I would try to answer your question, but probably in a slightly different way. First of all, this question we cannot pose in an abstract way, because the issue of development of science, advance of science, is related actually to the social and political needs of humankind. And what we understand at this stage, that unfortunately human beings, they became the hostages of scientific progress. The fact that we are hostages means that we cannot sustain 16 billion people, or sorry, not 16 billion, 7.5 billion people, 16 billion, this is the ultimate limit. We cannot sustain 7.5 billion people without actually science. Only because of science, we can somehow replace the resources, for example, mineral resources and technological resources in order to support 7.5 billion, I would say, people. Why? Because according to the modern estimate, If all 7.5 billion people lived like in America with the same level of consumption, we would need 4 planet Earth. Correspondingly, science is an attempt to make adaptation of our absolutely incredible demands to the physical conditions. And here, I think, the presence of science on the, in particular in the Orthodox frame, is absolutely paramount, in particular in these conditions, in this moment of time, because you know of ecological crisis, you know about the threat of the nuclear holocaust, you know that the potential which we created through physics of nuclear bombs is such that we can blow up this planet quite quickly. But the fundamental point, which is not understood by many people in the Orthodox communities, that unfortunately the amount of physical materials on this planet is limited. And the present estimate that only 16 billion people will be able to survive on this planet, because if we will go beyond this limit, it will be a disaster, because we will exhaust simple physical material, and this can be very simply calculated. This brings us to the fundamental issue within the Orthodox thinking. It's an issue when the problem of bioethics becomes the problem of ecology. Because many people, they say, okay, from a bioethical point of view, we can't control birth. We can't control population because it's a gift of God to have life. So that's why let God actually to take care about this. But this is fundamentally wrong. Fundamentally wrong because you completely disregard the laws of physics, which are laws of good God in the good creation. And the laws of physics tell you, no, you cannot procreate indefinitely. This planet will collapse. And that's why, I mean, definitely Orthodox theology, I mean, in particular in implications in bioethics, must clearly understand that bioethics and ecology becomes intertwined. It's impossible to separate. In different areas, for example, related to nuclear physics, of course, we are dealing with different ethical issue because, I mean, nuclear physics brought us to creation of atomic bomb. And atomic bomb is ultimately a sort of contradiction because it's a human creation, but at the same time, it destroys human life. So that's why Orthodox theology must always warn science that in its advance, it's capable of transgressing the boundary of the human. And here, theology must always remind the scientific community what is the meaning of human life and what is the value of human life, what is the ultimate value. Because sometimes scientists who produce, for example, either nuclear weapons or whatever technological application, they don't care about this. Because human life completely shifted towards a sort of periphery of non-being, because like economy is developed within itself and humanity, in particular personal humanity, hypostatic humanity, is disregarded. It's only a couple of examples where I believe it's a serious problems which we have. And I'm more and more convinced after nearly 30 years in this dialogue that the Orthodox community and Orthodox theologians, they must actually carefully study what science is saying, because unfortunately, science is saying that our existence is fragile. It's just, you know, it's hanging on a kind of, you know, hair. And the point that theology, orthodoxy, Christianity will not be able to exist if we will disregard scientific laws. Because scientific laws, being objective, they can vape us out from this planet within a second.
So the final question, and you have been very patient. What thinkers, intellectuals or scholars would you identify as being especially prominent nowadays in the contemporary science and Eastern Christianity interaction? Do you have an opinion on this?
I'll try to do my best. I mean, if you ask me a question about the dialogue between science and Orthodox Christianity, it's difficult to say, to be honest, because I know practically all literature which exists, because I wrote a review on many books, and I believe that all of them, they somehow contribute to this dialogue. But I mean, there is no there is no fundamental advance in this dialogue. And I believe that there are two reasons for the lack of this advance. The first of all is the lack of the program and the telos, it means the goal of this activity. The second thing, unfortunately, the scientific and theological communities, they are polarized. They cannot interpenetrate each other, they cannot actually create this process, interfertilization, because they are different. And they cannot see that. In fact, the main problem which we are facing now in this dialogue, it's a problem of survival. It's a problem of survival. So that's why I can tell you that from a theological point of view, purely theological point of view, I think the ideas of John Zizioulas must be taken into account, first of all, because he is the most advanced contemporary theologian in the Orthodox world. And he at least understands this problematic, because I mean, I communicated with him personally, and he understands this problematic, and he understands what problems we have with theology. He understands, and he is capable of actually stating this clearly, what is missing. In particular, I mentioned this concept of the fall, for example, the concept of the bioethical and ecological, I would say, intertwining. Up to some extent, I could say about Christos Yannaras, but to less extent about theological part. Now, in scientific discourse, the station, I think it's even worse. It's even worse because the difficulty that in the Orthodox world we have some, I would say, group of scientists, and you know they are present at this conference. But I did not see any particular systematic writings on the dialogue between science and theology, which would be balanced in scientific, philosophical, and theological terms. Because what we need not apology. Because sometimes we have the books like this. I mean, people, they quote the Greek fathers, and they say, well, the Greek fathers were saying that actually this type of dialogue is possible. But you know, you can take any book on patristic concept of nature, and you will find in any book on patristic concept of nature this type of claim. The question is the following: what to do with this? What is the meaning of this type of demonstration? Because you know, I was brought in the Soviet Russia, and in the Soviet Russia we had dialectical materialism and its approach to physics, approach to chemistry, approach to biology, approach to something. You see, if we want to make theology the substitution of the dialectical materialism and say that this is a meta discourse which exceeds actually all practical science and affairs, this would be a fundamental mistake, because it would be rejected by contemporary society, I'm sure, outright. So that's why, first of all, I would say that we need to promote ethical understanding of science and scientific achievements. It means that we need to try to address issues related to the value of human life, first of all, either on the grounds of bioethics or on the grounds of ecology, for different types of scientific communities who would actually control their experiments and, let's say, sponsor particular, I would say, military projects and other things in view of this potential danger. At the same time, I would say that the prevalence and this abundance of scientifically ideological fiction, as I would say, science fiction, which promotes idea of the complete dominance of science and its last word in the state of affairs in the world, this is another, I would say, time bomb, because effectively it gives you absolutely a wrong representation of science, because science is beautiful. For example, you take any book on cosmology, I mean, someone was quoting, I don't remember who was quoting Krauss, this cosmologist Krauss. But I mean, the difficulty that Krauss, he writes very nice books, but these books, they are talking about the universe which is completely inhuman. It has nothing to do with humanity. So that's why he's talking about death. So that's why if we are capable of understanding from the theological perspective that some cosmological books, it's a book about the hell. When you look at the sky, this is exactly explication of the hell. You remember, again, Father Archimandrite Sophronius Sakharov, he was saying, keep your mind in hell, despair not. And this is exactly what I say to my colleagues astrophysicists, keep your mind in hell, but despair not. Because if you go there, you will be destroyed immediately. You would not exist, you see. And this understanding must be brought to people, because sometimes they're so admiring this physics, so admiring this scientific picture of the universe, but they don't understand that this is non-existential physics. is the physics of death.
That's it, I believe.
thank you very, very much for your time and for your very erudite answers.